Welcome to Commodity Pulse. I'm Chris Newcomit, Washington, D.C. Bureau Chief for S&P Global Platts. With us today is Neil Chatterjee, Chairman of the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, the primary regulator of natural gas and power markets, natural gas infrastructure, and hydropower licensing. Neil was confirmed by the Senate in early August, along with fellow Republican Robert Powelson, putting an end to an unprecedented six-month period during which FERC lacked the minimum number of three commissioners needed to conduct its full range of business. While Mr. Chatterjee will soon hand the chairman's gavel to the newly confirmed Kevin McIntyre, he will remain as a commissioner, pursuing the priorities he's laid out during his first 3 months at FERC. Chairman Chatterjee, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
You've mentioned just recently as today that the backlog of items that built up during close to 7 months of inactivity at the commission will soon be worked off. And I'm sure you will get to some of your priorities, but perhaps we should first confront the 800-pound gorilla in the room. There's a DOE-driven notice of proposed rulemaking on your desk and your fellow commissioners that asks you to come up with a plan to tweak power markets to better acknowledge the baseload long-term benefits of certain types of power generation. And we're talking about coal and nuclear. We're in the midst of the comment process back and forth over that. And I think it's safe to say that there's been a fair degree of skepticism. I wonder if you can speak to what folks are saying, that pushback, that what you would contemplate here would be a distortion of the markets.
Thank you for the question. I think there's no doubt that the amount of attention being paid to the agency as we deal with this notice of proposed rulemaking, it's the highest the scrutiny's ever been, and we want to make sure we do it correctly. I want to start off by commending Secretary Perry for his leadership on this. The issues that he raised with the NOPR are not new. As our markets and our energy markets have evolved, we've seen these challenges, and we've been aware that there was pressure on some of these units that's been happening for some time. These are the kinds of complex, vexing questions that, if not tackled head on, can be punted forever. You can always kick the can down the road. And so what Secretary Perry did by initiating this conversation is give us a forum in which we could actually address this. Now, there have been numerous comments that have been put in about the NOPR specifically, and there have been questions raised about its legal viability. That said, there's also been a pretty consistent sentiment expressed that the question of valuing long-term resilience and examining whether or not there are attributes that certain generating sources have that aren't accurately being gauged by the markets today, that we need to look at that question. And I think the beauty of the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission is we have tools within our kit that will enable us to answer Secretary Perry's call in a legally defensible way that doesn't distort existing markets. Mm-hmm.
Again, procedurally, you have started to put a little bit of meat on the bones here, the approach going forward. You've just recently started to talk about a two-step process, an interim and a long-term process. This interim solution that you talk about is to address, and you have said, to address market conditions that presently are leading to or helping cause the retirement of coal and nuclears. What market conditions? What are you talking about?
So there is certainly short-term pressures on certain attributes being driven by low cost of gas, subsidized renewables. They put a lot of pressure on baseload coal and nuclear generation. I think there's agreement that we all need to look to the long term to say, hey, do we need fuel diversity? Do we need these baseload assets that have on-site fuel in the future? My concern is, as we do the long-term analysis, I don't want to have any regrets at the end of this. I don't want to find at the end of the process that we did, in fact, need some of these units, but because of short-term market pressures, they were taken offline. Because once these plants are shut down, they're gone. You can't get them back. And so the reason I feel that we need an interim step is we've got to keep some of these plants afloat while we do the longer-term analysis mm-hmm. to determine whether they're necessary or not.
Okay. Let's shift gears a little bit. before this NOPR, there was one of the more popular topics was how do you harden the grid? You know, there is a great vulnerability that people talk about for the grid, for electric utilities, and grid operators and utilities say, yeah, well, you know, all of the type of cybersecurity that we can put in and actual physical protection costs money, and we can't recover it under the current structure. Talk a little bit about how that play out.
I think one of the great things and one of the reasons I wanted to pursue a seat on the commission is I'm excited by technology and technological innovation. And I think that applies to the way that we generate and consume electricity. And I think the evolution of some of these technologies has really been remarkable and has the capacity to change the way that our interactions with our utilities are. I look to energy storage certainly as one of the areas where I think it's really remarkable the advancements that we've seen. But as this technological innovation has come, it has come with a downside, and that is increased vulnerability to cyber threats and physical threats. And I think it's important that we stay ahead of those threats. Now, FERC has a process in place. We work closely with NERC on their standards, but those standards are a floor, not a ceiling. And I think we need to continually work to stay ahead of physical and cyber threats to the grid. And I intended for that to be a focus. Now, you said these things cost money. Doing what is right is not always what is popular. I intend to do what's right.
Understood. Continuing to shift gears, let's move on to pipeline certification, another fairly high-profile item. The commission has been running into headwinds, fair to say, over the last year or two in the form of environmental groups, states, and the courts themselves. Does this show a lack of confidence in FERC's expertise?
I don't think so. I think our process is sound. I think it's legally defensible. I think it could be faster, but I think as we find those efficiencies, we can do them without cutting corners. We need to make sure that we don't sacrifice safety, we don't sacrifice compliance, and that we don't create any legal back-end litigation risk or legal vulnerabilities. I think we have a sound process. I think the courts have repeatedly upheld our process. I believe they'll continue to do so. But there's always things that we can look to do to improve our process. And I intend to focus on that during my tenure at the commission as well.
Good. Neil Chatterjee, thanks for taking the time with us. Best of luck with your remaining time on the commission. I am Chris Newcomet, Bureau Chief here in the Washington, D.C. office. Thank you for joining us on Commodity Pulse, and look for future Commodity Pulses. And follow us on Platts.com and check out Inside FERC. Gas Daily Megawatt. Thanks again.